Good afternoon. Good evening to my family watching this at home. It's about midnight for them, so they promised to take a look. So, and hello to future generations who will look at this. I'd like to acknowledge first, before starting, a PhD student of mine, Gerard Dam, who did some work on this presentation, and myself, of course, Bruce Jeffy from USGS Santa Cruz, and Dano Rulfink, and this is then apart from the organizing committee of this very nice symposium. I will talk about estuarine morphodynamics, because that's my specific area of interest. Let me start with this. Well, I'm getting a little bit nostalgic showing this movie to you. Oh, I'm supposed to click right here, because it's 8 years ago that I made this movie, and maybe you remember. this shows basically a Delft 3D run over about 3,000 years. What you see here is basically a tidal basin. There's no inflow from here. At this site, a delta is forming. There's a tidal movement only, one half meters tidal amplitude. And you can see that there's morphological updating, and you can see nice patterns evolving. There's a delta, but I don't consider deltas. It's kind of collateral damage to me in this movie. You see a nice meandering pattern evolving, and the nice thing about this is that this highly nonlinear system with the shallow water equations of Delft 3D and all the sediment transports involved, it's an Englund-Hansen type of transport, bed slope effects included, is able to reproduce a kind of equilibrium situation. Yeah? And it is something that also, it's not chaotic, it's something that's gentle and for a very schematized case, this is, gives you kind of confidence in what Delft 3D is able to do. But of course, it would be nice to do that also for real life, so real case studies. I'm pressing a button here, which I'm not supposed to press. If you translate the model results in a different way, you can see here the translation into energy dissipation levels. So in the beginning, you have a lot of energy dissipation. So energy dissipation means high shear stresses, high sediment transports, large amount of sediment being transported over ebb and over flood distributed. And this is then over the time scale of about 3,000 years. And you can see that the energy dissipation levels, they drop considerably, and also that it's more symmetric, distributed over ebb and flood after 3,000 years. So that means there's less morphodynamic activity, and there's a kind of trend towards equilibrium. If you want to look at this in a real life case, you need very well bathymetric data set of 3,000 years. So we don't have that. So. First, I want to take you to the weather forecast. Going to Boulder, I was very much interested in basically the temperature. And you have all kinds of temperature weather forecast, temperature models that in the beginning they predict very nicely, quite nicely. And in the end, after 2 weeks, there's a lot of variation between the different models that you use. You can translate that towards morphodynamic modeling with Delft 3D. You have the uncertainty trumpet, where you start with fluid dynamics, then you include sediment dynamics in your calculation, you update your bed, you include the sediment transport, the morphodynamics, and well, there's you're increasing the error that you introduce into your system. That is what we would think of intuitively, and the question is this true or not? What is a model like Delft 3D, what is it doing in a realistic case? What kind of line is it following? To explore that, we focused on the Western Scheldt. I have two case studies, one is the Western Scheldt in the Netherlands, the other is San Pablo Bay in San Francisco Bay. first discussed the Western Scheldt. It's very nice estuary because there's not so much sediment supply. Tidal forcing is relatively constant, or is constant. There's not so much storms that mess up things. It's a sandy environment, so it's an ideal case study to test the model. And I'm going to reproduce then the patterns of shoals and channels in this estuary. Well, this is then the Pheno model, which is basically Delft 3D. I will skip that a little bit. This is explaining the resolution. So it's a finite element method, and you can see that the major morphodynamic features are covered by the resolution of the model. That's the important thing here. We have on a very regular basis, we have bathymetry starting from 1860. So that links with the previous, I was glad that I can make the link to the previous presentation, because I saw the hindcast from 1960 onwards. I do the same. And after 1955, I have bathymetries every 2 years. So let's take a look. Here you can see the modeled patterns, and here the measured patterns after 18 years. 30 years, 45 years, 71 years, 95 years, 100 years, and 110 years. You can see if I go back that in the beginning it doesn't look good. There's some similarities, but if you continue a little bit, then you can see striking similarities. We can translate that also in a Bryce skill score. Bryce skill score means that if it's one, it's perfect. Huh? You have the perfect model. If it's zero, you are as good as your initial conditions. If it's below zero, you should not have started your modeling effort at all. And if it's between zero and one, it's doing well. It's going from bad to good. You can also translate it in a kind of error, because the error is then the difference between the measured profile and your model profile, and the signal. The signal is then the difference between your initial condition and your measured development. And this is the Bryce skill score over time. So you see indeed that in the beginning, the first 18 years, or the first 30 years almost, you have negative Bryce skill scores. And counterintuitively, the Bryce skill score increases over time a lot, up to levels which you could refer to as reasonable to fair. I would say it's quite promising, it's quite good. If you translate that into errors and signals, you can see in this plot that the error is indeed increasing. So that is what we intuitively would expect. There's an increase of error, there's a buildup of errors. But the reason why the Bryce skill score is increasing as well is that our signal, that's the red line, is increasing more than the error. One of the reasons for this is in the beginning, the initial conditions are not good. I only apply one grain size. There's mud. In reality, there's mud. There's bed slope effects. There's non-erodible layers. All these things are happening, and the model first adjusts to its very poor defined initial conditions. That's what you see in the beginning. But what takes it over on the longer term is probably the interaction of the main tidal constituents with the plan form of the basin. And starting from a flat bed, you see that process. I put in the same amount of sediments as was present in 1998. And the patterns that you see evolving over here really look like the patterns of the 1998 bathymetry. So the shape, the plan form of your basin determines to a large extent how the morphological development is going to take place. If I start at different points in time with the same data set, I see quite a large similarity in the development of the Bryce skill score. And also if I translate it into errors and signals, you can see that after 30 years, the signal becomes larger than the error. That means you need a kind of 30-year morphodynamic spin-up before you can trust your model results. If you remember, the first picture I showed you, the first movie was this decrease in energy dissipation levels. You can see that here also. So this is the modeled development in energy dissipation levels, and the straight line is well, the calculated energy dissipation levels based on the measured bathymetries. And you see in both systems that they have decreasing energy dissipation levels. And well, from this point onwards, there's a lot of dredging involved. So and that may a little bit explain the discrepancy between measured and modeled developments over here. So we are basically modeling with our model the blue line. Huh? So the error increases, but the signal increases even more. The model is then particularly suitable for longer term developments. If you want to study climate change impact of sea level rise, then this model is perfectly suited for that. And there's a kind of a general research question of how to decrease the morphodynamic spin-up time. You could increase the skill of, or decrease the morphodynamic spin-up time by including, for example, mud, and which is also present in this estuary, or maybe tidal fluctuations, deep spring tidal cycles, and that will increase the skill score a little bit more, I guess, here. So going back to America, California, we are in this huge catchment of the Sacramento River and the San Joaquin River. They confluence in an area referred to as the Delta. And here you can see in subsequent, all the river flows into Suisun Bay, San Pablo Bay, before discharging through the Golden Gate into the ocean. About 150 years ago, they found gold there, and huge amounts of blasted sediments, so they're washing out the gold from the sediments by blasting mountains and by hydraulic mining, and then adding some mercury to get the gold out. So a lot of huge amounts of contaminated sediments were flowing downhill and towards the estuary. This is then a little bit overview of the estuary, Suisun Bay, San Pablo Bay, Golden Gate. And here you can see measured developments. So you see this is the 1850 to 1890, so this is exactly the period of the hydraulic mining. You see a lot of deposition occurring, and this is the period 1950 to 1980, where the hydraulic mining stopped in about 1890. They constructed lots of dams in the catchment, and that resulted in a very limited supply of sediments from the delta towards the estuary, and that large parts of the bay became erosional as a result. The data is again very, very detailed. They did a good job from 1860 onwards. So basically, there are three characteristic periods: the hydraulic mining period, lots of deposition; the erosional period, because of the limited sediment supply; and the impact of climate change in future. So about 8 million cubic meters per year deposited in San Pablo Bay in the depositional period. And in typically the erosional period, there was an erosion of about an order of magnitude smaller, 0.8 million cubic meters per year, still a considerable amount of sediments. Focus is then on reproducing these patterns with Delft 3D. So this is a nice view of what happened. You see a lot of deposition on the shoals here and narrowing of the channel. So the aim of the study was to hindcast the bathymetric changes in San Pablo Bay, to assess the uncertainty levels and to predict future developments. With Delft 3D, I'm not going into detail here, we have to schematize the tide, we have to schematize the river flow and the river supply of sediments. There's wind that we needed to include, there is sediment transport of sand, but also by mud. In total, we have about 53 unknown parameters that we are dealing with. So this causes, again, a lot of uncertainty about the model results. Some of them you have to guess, you have to intelligently guess, some have to schematize. Can we trust then the model outcomes? Well, this is the model outcomes. And so this is the measured patterns, depositional period, erosional period, and this is the model patterns. And the difference then between the depositional period and the erosional period is indeed the supply, or basically the sediment concentration at the river boundary over here. And you see that Delft 3D is doing a pretty good job in reproducing these patterns. And you can even make predictions here. Well, this is, by the time I started this study, this was still a forecast. That's about 5 years ago. Now it's a hindcast. but you can run this continuously and make predictions for the coming century, and also then include what could be the effect of sea level rise on these patterns. Nice thing about Delft 3D is you can use it as a virtual laboratory now, and you can discriminate between wet season and dry season, and you can see what processes are when important, and where is the sediment coming from, and all kinds of nice exercises. You can read all about that in some publications. But we are here to discuss uncertainty levels, and you can see a range of model parameters that are varied. The black line here indicates the measured volume for the deposition period, the erosion period, and the future. And here you can see the reproduction of the model. And based on that, you can already see that if I vary my model parameters within reasonable range, I can still have similar type of volumes. And also the Bryce skill score shows a little bit the same development over here. There's not so much variation given the variations of the input parameters. Maybe the wind here is most sensible, or the river discharge. There's some difference between the depositional period because the wind is, and the erosional period because during the erosional period the wind is how do you model the wind is very sensitive here, and the river discharge, the supply of sediment, has most uncertainty over here. How much percent of then the model results has skill? Huh? So how well is the model reproducing the observed patterns? And what is the confidence level that we have given the input parameter uncertainty? We again have the Bryce skill score, but we also have a kind of confidence index, which from an ensemble of runs that I showed you, varying the model input parameters, we have a mean value, but also a standard deviation. So this is the measured pattern, this is the model pattern of the ensemble averaged values, this is standard deviation, this is mu over sigma, or sigma over mu if you turn it around the Bryce scale. And this is the pattern that you get if you take all the area that has a Bryce scale that's larger than 0.5, or a confidence index that's larger than 0.3. Yeah? And if you then multiply this pattern with your ensemble averaged, you can calculate basically the volume that answers both criteria. And you can get a graph like this. For the deposition period, you have a lot of confidence in the model outcomes. There's not so much variation. That confidence is decreasing for the erosional period because the wind schematization, which is a really unknown parameter in this setting, is very important for the erosional patterns that you see. That is one explanation. The other explanation is that for erosion, you need basically data of how is the sediment eroding, not on the top layer, but also on the lower layers. And that's very difficult data to get aware of. Skill score is about 57% of the modeled erosion and sedimentation volume fulfills the Bryce skill score of 0.5. That's also decreasing for the erosional period. So if you combine confidence index and the Bryce skill score, you get about 53. So 53% of the volume is we are confident and it has skill. You can also use this methodology then to investigate what parameters have caused the most uncertainty in your model outcome. Huh? So we're doing then an ensemble, not of all the model parameters, but per model parameters, for example, the critical shear stress or the river discharge. And by varying then the confidence index threshold, and here you can see the percentage of the volume that is answering that threshold. You can see here that during the depositional period, the parameter that causes highest uncertainty is the river discharge. And during the erosional period, the parameter causing largest uncertainty is the wind, but also the erosion factor. So if you want to do measurement campaigns in order to perform, to have a better performance of your model, you should do measurements about these two model parameters. It's a very helpful tool. So some concluding remarks. Estuarine morph dynamic development is better predictable on long time scales that exceed basically the time of the morphodynamic spin-up, which is typically decades. After decades, the model skill score becomes significant, and even in very complex environments. There's uncertainty levels by uncertain model input parameter settings, but they remain limited. I think both for the Western Scheldt and San Pablo Bay, the what's important is the plan form of your estuary that determines to a high degree where your sediment is depositing. And that is then the last remark. So thank you for your attention. I have here a list of it's a very ecocentric list, by the way, of all my publications over the past 6 years. But I can promise you that this list includes a lot of very useful references to work of others as well. So. So thank you for your attention.
Might have just been that I missed it, but I wondered if you could hold forth a little more on the actual sort of qualitative difference between confidence and skill in your model.
Yeah, that's this one.
Yeah, but can you give us translate it into how those two things could be different? Because intuitively you'd think they would correlate very closely with each other.
The skill is defined as how well is your model reproducing measured developments, and the confidence is how confident are you in your model results given the large variations or the uncertain model input parameters.
I may have missed it, but basically the results when you are showing us this comparison, is this result of your calibration or its validation? Did you run your model on an independent data set, basically?
I would say yes. I mean, it's with very default settings of Delft 3D, you get these results. And of course, the results depend, especially for San Pablo Bay, a lot of guessing, also the forcing conditions and the sediment supply. But also, if I vary then model parameters within reasonable bounds, in a reasonable range, the impact is not so high. That's basically what you see here. I mean, there are some variations. If I change the erosion factor by a factor 2 or the fall velocity by a factor 2, the roughness by 10%, diffusion by 10%, these are reasonable variations. I mean, these are typically variations that you would expect given a certain uncertainty. Of course, I can make the range larger, but what I then would see is that these patterns are similar. The patterns remain similar. Maybe the deposition volumes will be twice as small or twice as big. But the pattern makes me to conclude that basically the interaction of the plan form and the main tidal constituents determine to a high degree how these patterns develop.
Saying that the model is not sensitive to parameters, so therefore calibration is not even doing anything?
Well, I'm saying that it does something, but it is not. I mean, if you look here, you see that there is variation, and I had to do some calibration here. That's true. But on the other hand, you can also argue from the other side that I don't show here this sensitivity parameter. I don't include it in this presentation, but the patterns remain the same. So yeah.
Wondering in this simulation, how many grid points did you use?
The resolution.
Yeah, what is the resolution and what? Is it a body-fitted grid or?
About the resolution, so the typical resolution is about 100 by 200 meters.
I see. So the total number of grid nodes would be less than a million, right?
Yeah, so I didn't have your computing facilities. So a typical run of reproducing these things would cost me one day on a decent PC. And because of the large amount of runs that I had to do. I did some higher resolution to get it published. The patterns didn't look much different.